Cahokia. There aren't that many readily available about Cahokia. There are some, and these two are pretty generally known. Rowena, of course, will be talking about other work that has been done on Cahokia. I wanted to introduce and say a little bit about Dr. McClinton before we get started. I know a lot of you know her, have met her, worked with her before through the Trail of Tears Association. She speaks fairly frequently at Trail of Tears national meetings. That's where I first heard her. She is an associate professor at the University of, at Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville. She teaches historical research and historical research methods. So she's really into that sort of thing. She's also taught Native peoples pre-contact 1840, Native peoples 1840 to the present. I need to come and take both of those, I think. I'm a perpetual student and they sound fascinating. Indians encounter Lewis and Clark, Native American women, Indian resistance and Indian reform, history and social science pedagogy, First Peoples and Western ideology, land removals and reservations, African American music and the struggle for freedom, which she co-taught with Professor Prince Wells. Rowena is widely published, and I brought the first volume of the Moravian Spring Place Mission to the Cherokees. This is volume one. If you haven't seen it, you may want to look at it. And again, you can get it from me after the talk. Volume two has been published. She is currently working on an abridgment, a one volume abridgment to this two volume set. And when is it supposed to be out?
Well, it did come out.
Oh, it did. Okay, so it's already out. She's written numerous essays, chapters, and books. I'm not going to go through that very lengthy list, but hopefully this gives you an idea of the incredible scholarship and experience that Dr. McClinton brings to her talk this morning. So if you would, join me in welcoming Dr. Rowena McClinton.
Thanks so much, Kathy. And really, I want to thank so many people here in the audience, because if it weren't for many of you, I would not have gotten through the voluminous papers that I've been able to edit and transcribe, and in some cases translate, had it not been for the help of many of you in this audience. Because the history that I have, or the volumes that have been published about the history of the Cherokees, it belongs to the Cherokees. And so it's been an honor and a privilege to work with so many of you, and I want to thank each and every one of you. And I was thrilled to be asked to come here this morning. I'm so happy to see so many people here. Southern Illinois University, Edwardsville, is really only about 10 miles north of Cahokia Mounds. It's the largest excavated mound city in North America, and only about a tenth of it has actually been excavated so far. And I have handed out an outline, and I'm going to follow this outline, and if I miss something on it, then you can call me to that attention. And I've just more or less given rough sentences, words. I mean, some of this is not even in sentences. It's just a rough outline about this incredible site. Cahokia, as I said, is the largest excavated pre-contact site in the United States. Beginning around 1054 A.D., it lasted until around 1300 or sometime before, and some people even date it to 1400. Its population count during its zenith rivaled those of great European cities, Paris and London. And so this presentation with slides looks at this pre-contact city with its emphasis on recent interpretations of its beginnings and demise. Located amid the confluence of, Missouri, Mississippi, and Illinois rivers, Cahokia developed into the epicenter of trade and unearthed artifacts. And these artifacts tell of their flung trade routes that went as far as the Gulf of Mexico, the Great Lakes, and the Appalachians. And details outline its culture centered on mound building and worship of its sun king, living atop the largest earthen mound in North America called Mounds Mound. And also, I will be showing you slides of the Grand Plaza and the village and Woodhenge, the Cahokia calendar. This town or this city probably had at one time around 20,000 people as far as population was concerned. So you can imagine the number of fires it took to undergird such a population. So they were constantly using up the woods and the surrounding area, and also the wood to build stockades that also surrounded this extremely large city. One thing I do want to emphasize is that we really don't know exactly why Cahokia was founded. Archaeologists have surmised, they are the ones who've given us most of the evidence about Cahokia, but one of the latest books that was written about Cahokia, and I'm going to show it here, is Timothy K. Palkatet. He teaches at the University of Illinois. He's an archaeologist. This is a brilliant book, and he thinks that that Cahokia was founded around 1054 AD due to a supernova that appeared in the constellation Taurus. And that this, bright light out of this constellation Taurus shone for 23 days and nights. And it made such an impression on the people in the area that people started gravitating to this area that we call the American Bottom, the confluence of the Missouri, Mississippi, and Illinois rivers. And we also think that one of the reasons it held together was because they built a hierarchical society there. And the persons at the top of this hierarchy were called by Palkatet elites. But there was one out of the elite who was the sun god. And so this earthen mound was purposely built to house the sun god, because he would be the closest to the sun. And power, might, force came from the sun and then drifted down, through him and then to the rest of the villages. And the rest of the villages were divided up into different groups, farmers, slaves, and artisans, and different groups of people had different duties during this particular period of time. But this power emanated because of the power of the sun going through the Sun King and then going through the rest of the village. And this is what held this village together for so long. And much of this thinking has derived from the fact that the Natchez people who lived in present-day Natchez, Mississippi, who are now located around 1731, they were also mound builders. And when De Soto went through and encountered their sun god or sun king, they thought that same type of political leadership was also mirrored the leadership in Cahokia for some 300 or 350 years or so. So it's really conjecture. And so at the very end, I want to talk, want some of you to discuss why you think Cahokia had a demise, because I want, and why it all of a sudden these people start, or gradually these people started disappearing and forming other communities throughout the Southeast. Possibly the Cherokees, of course, could have been one, some of the people who were obviously descended from these people who lived in this area along the Mississippi River. Okay. This was this area is called the American Bottom, and it's a floodplain caused by, you know, the, of course, the flooding of these rivers, and we also have different ideas about the traits of Mississippian cultures. They were uniquely organized farming communities. And I don't want to forget here my slides. This shows you, of course, a picture of the rising sun. This photograph here, or this drawing here, is what they feel like DeSoto would have encountered at Natchez, a similar type greeting, except, of course, the Sun King was on a litter. But also, he would also be accompanied by different people at different times, and they had been able to replicate this cloth at the museum. So the ones of you who are going to the museum will be able to see this cloth actually being replicated, and it's very, very unique. There were various kinds of mounds that were built, and this mound here is Monk's Mound. As you can see, it is terraced. It was named Monk's Mound because Trappist monks lived there in the latter part of the 1700s. And early part of the 1800s, and then they also had a church on top of the mound, and because they were in the area and they had a church on top of the mound, it became known from other people who came into the area as Monk's Mound. And then you see here what Monk's Mound would have looked like in its heyday, a replica of it when it was, say, around 1300 or 1250 to 1300, or maybe a little bit later. And you see some semblance here of the great plaza that was also where many, many activities occurred, and we will talk about those. These are the different types of mounds, the ridge top, platform, and conical mounds, and platform mounds were used as charnel houses. The we know that this shows you another area here of the great plaza area, and I'm just going to linger here on this area just for a few minutes. This plain floodplain agricultural based society grew corn, and only one bean seed has been found so far in this area, which I think is so, so unusual. Now, squash was grown, your tubers or your Jerusalem artichokes were grown. You can sometimes find tubers and Jerusalem artichokes in the grocery store, and if you take them and you bake them like potatoes, they're absolutely delicious. Do not boil them, they become very sour. But if you just bake them, they're absolutely delicious, and they were dependent on these tubers. But they were also dependent on all different types of pumpkins, but the corn itself, they only grew, as far as we know, one variety of corn, and the temperature was varying at certain times during these three centuries that they were there. And so we think that the archaeologists think that the corn couldn't always adapt to the temperature changes because they only grew one type of corn. Whereas that some of your tribes up the upper Missouri were growing maybe six different types of corn, and their corn could adapt to different temperature changes. But this particular society just grew one type of corn, according to what these archaeologists have said. Also, there was specialization in based on basket weaving and pottery making, and I'm not, and I want to get to, just a minute, I'm going to get to the bird tablet. We also know that corn was used, the surplus of corn was grown, and even though the Sun King would have redistributed the corn among the needy ones in the village, we also know that they used corn as money so they could exchange and have this wide range of exchanges with persons living along the Mississippi Gulf Coast. They would trade for valuable seashells, copper in the Great Lakes region, and then mica in the Appalachian regions. So we know that that was the basis of their society was corn. And as you know, corn is a very labor-intensive crop, and it takes all the nutrients out of the soil, and there wasn't a bean crop there to put the nutrients back into the soil. So when we start talking about the demise, we want to think about how they exhausted the soil. Also, because of the extensive trade routes with the Mississippi and Mississippi culture, you can see here where the rivers do come together and where Cahokia is located at this site, and with the different rivers that are coming through that allow for this huge network of trade routes. We know that it was an intricately organized community that involved kinship and marriage and alliances. We have called the chieftainship. I think chieftain and chief are pejorative terms. Those are Western terms that have been imposed on Indian societies, either pre or post contact, to make for Westerners to make some political judgment or definition of how they thought these societies were organized. I was just reading a recent article about another archaeologist last night, and she totally opposes the term chiefdom because she feels like that was totally imposed, by the Spanish, and that it doesn't necessarily describe their political leadership. Because we don't really know their political leadership, but we're giving them something that we don't know. But it was a theocratic-type society because the Sun King and his leadership and the people, the secular and the spiritual were one. So we know it was a theocratic society. We know that there is a mobilization of peoples who carried millions and millions of baskets to form this Mounds mound, as you see here in the background, and also these other mounds. This Mounds mound was formed in such a unique way that different types of earth were put in different types of different places to ensure its integrity. So it was built for with a certain purpose in mind. These were magnificent architects who built Mounds Mound. They just didn't just throw just any kind of dirt anywhere. It was planned out very, very carefully. It took over a 50-year period of time to get to it, to the height that it got to. Also, we know that they built a 2-mile stockade around Cahokia, and we don't know exactly why they built this stockade, because there is no sign of a war having taken place, a warring from outsiders. But there was a 2-mile stockade, again, using up many of the trees in the area in order to build the stockade. They also created a calendar, and this is what's called Woodhenge. If you go up on top of Monk's Mound and you look westward toward the arch that's the signature piece of St. Louis, you will see Woodhenge, which was the way they calculated time, and the it's very, very unique. I was reading another interesting article last night. When you get to do something like this, you it's so exciting, because you get to read so many other points of view just besides what's just right here in this outline. But they also think that maybe perhaps at one time they took, because other cultures did this, they took skulls from persons who had been sun kings or had held very important positions in that society, and they had put their skulls on top of these poles as a form of worship. And that could be very, very likely, because it has shown up in other similar societies in other parts of the world around the same time. This particular person was quoting a society in Indonesia. There was also a plethora of tools. Like I said, they had a extremely crafted artisan class of people. And I'm going through the village here. I was going to see if I could find a separate picture of tools, but you can see here the some of the pottery that's being made. And then, of course, skinning this deer, and then grinding the corn. And this is the village of Cahokia itself. This is a replica of the village of Cahokia itself. I'd like to go back just to one other part of this. I'd like to emphasize the fact that this village was, that they used all the natural resources, of course, in the area. And so they used the prairie grass grown throughout this area as making these thatched roofs for their houses. And when you go there, you'll see a film that will explain all of this, and then a screen will lift up, and you will see this magnificent village, you know, right in front of you. Very, very unique. I'll go through this village and just show you what this village, and you can walk around this village, and you can see the figures here. And you will definitely get a chance to see this when you go. As you can see, you see how the early Native Americans fished, and also you see here the round boat that was used in so many different cases. Very unique. It was different from the ordinary canoe. Also, I'd like to go ahead and tell you something about some of the games they would have played on the plaza, and this grand plaza that I showed you in front of Mounts Mound. This game, I'm sure, is familiar with all of you. It's called Chunky. I know the Choctaws today I do know that they have contests going on, even today, Chunky contest. And I'm not perfectly sure how all the rules of the game are concerned, but I don't know that the stone is rolled, and whose spear gets closest to the place where the stone stops, then that person apparently wins the game. And if I'm incorrect, please feel free to correct me. Also, they also had a definite belief system, and I think that we know that this belief system has come down to us through the years, and I wanted to talk a little bit about this sacred piece called the Birdman's Tablet. The Birdman's Tablet was found around 1971 when archaeologists were just starting to go in there trying to save this whole area from asphalt and just total ruin. I mean, and being paved over with parking garages or so forth. And so, but when they found this bird tablet, he was on the east side of Monk's Mound. And this was quite a find because this tells us and reinforces to us even today the spirituality of so many Native American societies. The upper world, being here represented by the falcon or the bird, as you can see here, he has a beak on his face. And then, of course, this world represented by man or earth. And then the lower world being represented by the diamond-head rattlesnake. But I feel very close to this. I have one next to my bed at night. I think it's a very special figure that goes way back in time, and I'm not so sure how far back, whether they have an exact date when he was actually made, although he was found around 1971. But these three realms, of course, as you know, are still very much a part of many, many Native American societies, including, you know, Cherokees. And I always love telling my students this because you all know the answer anyway, but how would Cherokees, say, put out a fire? If you have three different worlds and you want to keep these worlds in balance and harmony, and you want to always make sure that we restore balance and harmony, then how would a Cherokee, say, put out a fire today? With the earth. Yes, you're absolutely right. And that's what I want. Because earth comes in between the upper world and the lower world, represented by water, and mediates, and therefore it doesn't cause any disharmony. So yes, you would not mix upper world with lower world. You wouldn't put out fire with water, but with earth, because it would be the mediator. And so that is what is, I think that's beautifully said, because I think Native American societies always strive for harmony and peace and goodwill to one another. There is conflicts are avoided. If there is a conflict, a shaman is hired to subdue or get rid of the conflict. Then we look at Cahokia as a place, of course, that had a wide variety of nuts and berries and a wide variety of fish, and I'll try to get back to that. That fishing scene, they had they hunted deer, and of course, though, as they were depleting the woods around Cahokia, then the deer population was being also displaced, as you know. The another interesting fact about Cahokia is, and we don't know as much about it as we would like to, and archaeologists are just getting to acknowledge some of the areas of of Cahokia when it came to using force and power and might, and possibly another reason that could have led to its demise. But at Mound 72, a man by the name of Melvin Fowler, and I have his book here, he's an archaeologist from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, he discovered this chieftain, and as you see, he is in a replica that they were able to replicate his clothing. He is surrounded by thousands and thousands of these seashells that have been rounded by an instrument that you will see when you go there to visit. And then in the center of this round disc is a hole that's also been rounded out by a wooden type of what we would, for lack of a better word, machine. And he also has chunky stones, and he's got all kinds of arrowheads or shirts buried with him. So we do know, of course, they believe in an afterlife. But also in this mound, they found quite a few bodies of virgin girls. And so we know that there were sacrifices made at different times while the Sun King was head of the of this village, or the leader of this village, and we don't know as much about the sacrifices, but because we do know that there were sacrifices being made, that this could have led, say, to some disruption in the society itself, but you don't hear too much about it. In fact, I've been to Cahokia many a time, and I don't believe it's on any signage there. It's just buried inside of some of these books. We don't associate the Cahokian culture with the Mayan culture at all. As far as we know, there's no correlation between the Mayans and the Cahokians. All the archaeologists and anthropologists and historians have made that very, very clear. There is no parallel between these two cultures, but they, as far as their having ever met up with one another or have ever known one another, this is not about Mayan culture and adopted from Mayan culture like we think the Natchez culture and the Cahokian culture were similar. Also, I will move on. And another thing that makes the Cahokian culture so unique are their figurines, and these all have different symbols. And of course, you see in this particular symbol, he's holding the chunky stone, and I'm not sure what. This is the last slide, and this is an aerial view of Cahokia, and I just want to make it a point to say that they used up all the natural resources they had in the area. I mean, they could use bark, of course, to stabilize their steam rooms. They could use willow and cattails, and of course, I've already mentioned the prairie grass. I mean, they used up as much of what was available to them in this very, very rich soil in the surrounding area, and I want to make one transition here, because when I'm teaching Cahokia, I'm talking about Cahokia, a pre-contact culture. And why it came to an end, and I want to talk with you in just a minute about why it came to an end and why you think it came to an end. I've always been fascinated by this book called Slack Farm. And not too far from Cahokia, in present-day northern Kentucky, near the Ohio River, right below what is present-day Cairo, Illinois, is a culture called the Caban Welborn people, and they are more or less a perfect transition from people who went from mound building and having a hierarchical society to one that was gradually changed into an egalitarian society that we find that developed throughout the Southeast, especially after DeSoto's march through the Southeast, after 1542, 1543, around 1600. We find most of these societies, when Europeans started really infiltrating these societies, we find that Native American societies had become more solidified in a less hierarchical way. And so Slack Farm is a transition of that mound building society and then transitioning to a more egalitarian society. And then you see that more or less filtrating down throughout the Southeast from northern Kentucky, then throughout below the Ohio River and on into your major tribes in the Southeast. And I think that's very interesting to tell students because one thing we know is that change is constant. And so we're always changing, and the Cahokians didn't stay the same. Of course, they ended up moving away. They had this great demise. But then they infiltrated, as we know, other societies, including Cherokees, all throughout the Southeast, and brought many of their specialties and many of their art and their farming abilities and everything else. I mean, it was a part of all these other societies that evolved and were evolving throughout the Southeast. So the last question I want to ask is, why do you think Cahokia declined? What are your reasons that, just from this little small talk, do you think Cahokia declined? I'm sorry, because of what reasons?
Over-farming of the soil.
Yeah.
Over-cutting of the timber. It changed the natural structures to the point where it would seem to be that many people in one place wouldn't be as sustainable. Our cities today are not sustainable. I mean, if you cut off the highways, any city has got maybe 3 days' worth of food in it, you know? Yeah. So, I mean, it would seem to have evolved into an unsustainable structure. That's just my
opinion. Well, I think you're exactly right. I mean, I honestly think you're exactly right. But had they used the bean, that might have promoted a more sustainable environment, culture, but in one aspect, okay. Yeah. Well, that's true, and this is what happens in these third world countries. I mean, and this is what happened with, you know, thousands and thousands of years ago, North Africa was covered with grass and trees and land sand. So, you know, this is, you know, man moving in and has always manipulated their environment. I mean, I think those are very good. And Ross, I'm sorry, what is your first name? Gail, I'm sorry. I knew you. I was going to call you Mary Jean, but I knew that wasn't right. Gail, I'm glad to see you. Oh, okay. I keep on bouncing off of this. It's supposed to be on television, and I hope it doesn't, you know, plug up somebody's ears. But anyway, I'm not used to microphones. Are there some other suggestions about the demise of the Cahokian society? I mean, as we know it, I mean, as Gail has pointed out and as Curtis has pointed out, it other ways that it could have brought about its demise. What about a hierarchical society? What about so much power in one person? Because might and force, and the forcing of their will, even though they worship this, you know, the sun, but forcing that will on so many people over a long period of time, and that's Palkatet's argument. He argues that it was because of the might and the power of that person at the top that after a while the generations just, you know, they just said, so what? I mean, you know, we're not going to buy into this anymore. We're going to move on. And then there was a political disruption, you know, as a result of having that vacancy or even maybe a lack of respect for someone there at the top. Yes. Right. She asked about the 100-year floods, and it did flood frequently. And when they started to tear down all the trees for these fires and to make these stockades, then there was no place for the water to go, because water, as you know, goes up the trees, and then it flooded the farmlands. You're right, That could be perfectly true. I mean, just natural disasters over a period of time. They could have suffered, say, a Katrina, and it could have just wiped everybody out. And just, I mean, or wiped out their lifestyle as they knew it. And, of course, modern technology was able to come into New Orleans and help rebuild. But even today, New Orleans hasn't gone back to where it was prior to Katrina. So natural disasters, it certainly is a possibility. Are there any other comments? Yes, Jimmy.
Is there any archaeological connection to spirals?
You know, I yes.
We had Bennett Peterson here in Jeremiah a year ago, January or February,
I went over there just to see. I did have a desk that was done from the Spiro Mounds, and of their carvings, and that is, as far as I know, and just to add to what I may still be able to find it in one of my bags that I brought, but that would be the westernmost mound building culture as we know it. Is that right? Okay. And then Chillicothe in Ohio, with your serpentine mounds, would be your most eastern, and then of course you have the Etowah, and you know, and down that it swoop around, you know, all in this area. Would almost make a circle.
The Etowah mounds are in this same area?
Yes. But Cahokia, as Kathy said, was considered the epicenter for trade, and was considered the most powerful of all these mound building cultures. Yes. Yes.
Isn't that considered to be about 1,000 years even older?
I think so. I think it predates the Mississippian era. Well, and I, my, this book here, I think I have a, I thought I had a and I apologize if I don't, I cannot find the exact date, but a poverty point. But it was a, but it was a, it was a, it was, and it was, it does predate this particular time period, but I'm not sure exactly what the date is. I don't have it right in front of me here in this book. But afterwards, if you'll come up, we'll look together, if that's okay. Okay. It might be. It might be. You know, I'm not sure how to answer that, and it's not an area that I have actually studied, other than just to point it out on a map, and so I'm afraid to give any kind of rendition to what you've said, because you could possibly be absolutely right. Well, Jimmy, that's a great question. I think it depends on who you talk to. There's so little known. If we didn't have archaeologists, we wouldn't really know anything about any of these cultures. There's some historians who honestly think that Cherokees, descended from these mound-building cultures. There are other historians who claim that the Cherokees were unique and were separate from the mound-building cultures entirely, and that they came in from the west over the Arkansas River and then settled into the southeast. Francis Jennings was a scholar who held that belief, but then you have the Iroquois culture to the north and northeast of the Cherokee culture, which spoke the same language, and you have these rest of these mound building cultures, the other four speaking a Muscogean language. So So whether they came in from the West or and how much they were influenced, I do think that all, I think, I personally, I'm just going to guess. I surmise that all cultures in the Southeast were influenced by these mound-building cultures because, whether it was Poverty Point or Slack Farm or Cahokia, They were all influenced because they were legacies of it in some way, fashion, or form. But how one traces that, I think your question is great, but I have no idea. And I think that has been a question of whether Cherokees historically would have even been a part of these mound building cultures, but
they're not that far removed.
No, they're not geographically, they're not. So I think that just because you bring certain things together and then you just draw some type of conclusion. And it may be absolutely correct, but there may be some variations there too. Yes.
Are there any issues with disease?
Yes, there are. It's a very good question. They ate a lot of corn, and that caused, of course, the decay. And we know this from the decay of the teeth was very, very prevalent among the Cahokian peoples. They also contracted tuberculosis, and but not, you know, measles or smallpox or any of these other diseases that came in later because of Europeans. But there were some, but there was tuberculosis. So the disease could have played a big part in causing the demise, especially because they depended on just that one crop, corn, for the everyday subsistence. But then again, you know, they did have deer and fish and in the area, but corn was their mainstay. That's a very good question. Yes. Hey.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So when you go gather things, you know, you only take so much, and you go to different places, right?
Yeah.
And so you assume that they did this too, you know, as much as they could, or they cultivated those things that they gathered as much as they could too.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, that kind of makes me think about that they were able to sustain it as long as they did. But then also, when you think about disease, that many people. It would be hard to avoid these things, even from, you know, even if they had really good systems for their waste, you know, you know, because of bacteria
mm-hmm.
and the things that kind of sicknesses that come from that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, to me, it's amazing that they lasted as long as they did.
Yes.
But then, spiritually, if you think about that part too, if there was a theory that they all came together in that place,
mm-hmm.
For certain mm-hmm. reasons, for spiritual reasons or whatever, and they grew, you know, spiritually in that place. There were probably reasons why they left too, because, you know, spiritual growth, or to be able to grow spiritually, it's kind of like you're led and you make choices.
Uh-huh.
You know.
Yeah.
So they were probably led to a certain point where, you know, you can't just stay here.
Right, and it didn't happen just overnight. It was a gradual,
that,
yeah.
That particular place where they were at, that culture, mm-hmm. maybe is gone, but, you know, we're
also
here.
Yeah, right, this is your legacy. I mean, part of, you know, what you're doing here today, I think, would come from, you know, from these people. Yeah.
Hunger,
yeah.
Disease from depletion of resources, that could have been, you know, in a fully integrated society where there's no separation between mm-hmm. secular and spiritual and political mm-hmm. and religious, that could have caused literally a crisis in faith.
Yeah.
In terms of this top down structure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, the disruptions from the
yes.
From the
Well, that you know, political and the political unrest, I think, you know, it's certainly been pointed out, and you said it beautifully, Gail. Did you have another question?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm sure there were groups that decided to move on.
Yes. And I believe that we've always found that in Native American societies, they've always been very adaptable, you know, and whatever's happened. I mean, the adaptation has been remarkable, and that will to survive has just been so remarkable that I think that everyone in this room is a part of that survival, and I think I think you're exactly right. And we can certainly, I mean, look to these people that we will never know or never have contact with, but we can, you know, teach our children, teach our classes, or teach one another, you know, the value of appreciating what these earlier cultures did and the contributions that they made to humankind. So thank you. Yes, did you have a question?
Well, yeah. I was just thinking about the demise of the mm-hmm.
Well, I think that's well said. You know, fenced in, and of course that was one of the biggest differences when Europeans did finally start infiltrating Native American societies. Native American societies didn't have fences. You know, Europeans brought their own fences. So I think your point is extremely well taken. And also the point about sacrifice, that certainly could have caused, you know, disruption. And especially if they were going up the ladder and say and sacrificing the Sun King's daughter or someone in a more powerful, mightier position, that could have certainly caused a lot of disruption. So, yes, uh-huh.
I'm not too familiar with this history, so forgive me if it's a silly question.
There are no silly questions. As far as we know, there's no evidence of war. And as far as we know, at the zenith, there were 20,000 people. Now, that number has come down somewhat. The last time I was at Cahokia, they were saying they thought maybe around 15,000 people at its zenith. So, you know, that number is also in flux. But as far as we know, they were not warring people at all, and like she said, you know, maybe that was to keep the people in. I mean, you know, the stockades out.
And my last question, yeah. I'd be remiss not to ask a clothing question.
Okay.
If the textiles. Yeah. Taken from artifacts, the visual image of clothing.
Yeah, I'm not an expert on this, and somebody else is, but maybe Kathy, you can help me out. But I think things with carbonization, they were able to resurrect this clothing. Is that correct? Well, we would know these would be definitely, vegetable dyes, that were put, into this fabric. And this was the piece I was just looking for a while ago. This was carved by an artist from Spiral Mound. And I don't have anything like it. Yeah, you can please pass it around. But we don't have anything like that I know of from the Cahokia Mounds. Anything that's that intricate. I mean, that they have found yet. But like I said, less than 10% of Cahokia Mounds has been excavated. Less than 10%. So there's a lot more to find out, and there's a lot more we'll never find out because it's been bulldozed over. So a lot's been lost. But at least the state of Illinois came in the 60s and realized how valuable this piece of property was, and this was a real ancient culture, and we needed to preserve it. And it was made into a World Heritage Site by UNESCO, and so we have something, to be very, very proud of that here, in Illinois. I mean, this is a World Heritage Site, and there are not that many around the world. Yes. Well, that's what the book tells me. That's information I've gotten from books and from professors and historians, archaeologists, anthropologists, but. That's a very good question. I think a lot of people have tried to make those connections, but apparently, there is no connection. I think it's you've asked a very, very good question. But I wish I could help you out, but I can't.
Do you think at any point in the future people may be able to make that connection?
I have no idea, I've only been to I've only been to the Mayan ruins once in my life, and I can't. There's some similarity, just like with the pyramids in Egypt. I mean, there's some similarity in the way they went about building Mounts Mound and these other mounds at Cahokia, but. But to say that any of these cultures copied one another, apparently there's no evidence of it. Right now, there's not. But there may be one of these days. I think one thing you do is you never say never, because you never know. You never know. There was a question back here. Well, the Cahokians But let me just go back. When the French came in and settled Illinois, in the latter part, especially around the mid 1800s to the latter part of the midpoint 18th century. Excuse me, not 1800s. Midpoint 18th century. They named the Indians in this area Cahokians, and they were part of this Illinois Confederacy, and they were Algonquian speakers. And so what was there when the French came in 1750 and what had been there in 1300, that's, you know, I don't know what, you know, I don't know, you know, exactly that space of time, see. But it could, you know, they could have been, part of them could have been descendants, yes. Did I answer your question? Okay. Yeah, hi, yes, Jera.
The question I was having was about the language. How did they train with all these different areas?
Because there's no, well, you know, Indians were the first to use sign language. So I'm sure sign language was used. But how they actually traded and what languages were spoken, other than that we know Muskogean, of course, was spoken with the Choctaws, the Natchez, and that was really the lingua franca of languages for a long time. And so, but I have no idea, you know, how they...
Yeah.
But that would be the Muskogean.
It developed as tribes came more and more into contact with each other, and it's called the Mobilian, as in mobile, Mobilian mm-hmm. trade jargon. And it was kind of like pidgin English. All the peoples that traded with one another, they learned it just enough to be able to trade with other peoples. Because that was something that I've been very interested in.
Okay. And so would they? And so they would have had Muskogean mixed into the Mobilian
sure.
language. Yeah. Because, yes, are there any other questions or any other comments anybody would like to make? I'd be happy to. Yes.
You mentioned about the belief system. Mm-hmm. That is something that is
carried
over to a lot of different.
Yes. Yeah, right. Yeah, the three levels, the three realms, yes. So we know we have that. And they're just magnificent, I think, to know about those three levels and what they stand for. Are there any other comments? Anybody else have a comment? Yes. They're still excavating, and they're doing some excavation now in East St. Louis, and that was a nearby satellite, if I'm using that modern-day term, of Cahokia. And so they're trying to find out the similarities and how they were trading and what they were trading for, you know, with with East St. Louis, which is not very far from this site. And I'm not sure about any kind of excavations across the river. I do think that it supposedly there were some mound-building cultures in and around St. Louis, but I do know that there was a significant one right outside the gates of Cahokia at East St. Louis, and they are doing some excavation there. But as far as Cahokia goes, there always are excavating. I mean, they always have teams there every summer from Europe, from around the United States, that are there excavating different parts of the site. Okay. Well, listen, thank you all so very, very much. I enjoyed it. It's really been a lot of fun. I always love coming here. Thank you.
Joanne, do you want to say just anything briefly about the Moravian records that you've worked on?
Oh, yeah, okay. I don't have a copy right here in front of me, but I had the privilege of, along with many of you in this room and the Moravians in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, of translating, transcribing, and editing two volumes of Anna Rosina Gombault's diary about the Cherokees. She was with the Cherokees from 1805 to 1821. She died in February of 1821. And she got there in October of 1805. And so really 1805, 1821 are bookends to the years in between. But she was a scrupulous keeper of records, and she was a careful observation of Cherokee culture. And she recorded numerous names of the Cherokee families, the children who came into the mission. She kept charts of where the children were from, where the parents lived, sometimes how many miles away their home was from Spring Place Mission. She also recorded numerous stories about the slaves from the nearby Van Plantation. It was really a joined Spring Place Mission. James Van had allowed the Moravians to rent 25 acres of land, and then around 1814, they expanded that to 35 acres of land, and there was a fairly fluid society at that time, and so peoples in bondage were able to come into the mission and seek help when they were sick. They also came to the Moravian services, and so there are many stories about these people who were held in bondage. But these stories are just magnificent. But I'm so engulfed at this point with the delicate way in which she handled Cherokee origin stories. She has many stories in the two volumes about Cherokees coming in and telling where they've come from, how much they revere the female. For instance, chief to me is a pejorative term, but warrior's nephew came in one day and said, "The mother of our nation is very angry with you," talking about the Cherokees. He had said this in council. He says, "Because you beat each other until the blood flows." And, of course, corporal punishment was a European practice. It was something introduced to the Cherokees later. Introduced maybe than the 1790s, but it was mainly used by the Light Horse Brigade if young men were found stealing horses. They were lashed quite severely, and that was not a Cherokee practice. And the Light Horse Brigade was a Cherokee police force, as many of you know. But there's so much reverence for the female, and of course in the Moravian society there's a lot of respect for the females also. So she really picked up on the importance of females in Cherokee society and how they sustain their power within the family. To me, it's very spiritual to work with such documents when one is looking at people who at that time did not have a written language until Cahokia came along in 1821, and yet you have someone there living among the Cherokees who carefully describe Cherokee life. And it was a very magnificent experience that I was able to have a part of. Okay, thank you. Thanks again. And I'm sorry I kept on bumping the. I guess all the bumps are going to be out your.